Hello everyone, today is 31st of March. My name is Sahil and welcome to the newspaper analysis. Now guys, first of all, let's have a look on today's GS folder. Today we'll take a quote from Albert Einstein, the notable physicist. He had talked about the peace. He says, peace cannot be kept by force. It can only be achieved by understanding. Guys, this particular quote becomes relevant into the essays related to the peace, harmony, as well as into the international relation, because peace is the dominant theme. Now guys, it also becomes even more relevant into the context of peace talks that is going on into the context of Afghanistan. Now, majorly it has been seen that the America and Russia, they are brokering the talks, but often they are trying to enforce the peace by taking up the commitments, but the focus onto the understanding, that is onto the intra-Afghan talks, is not being made about. Now guys, into this particular context, India's role is notable because India had always drawn three red lines into the context of Afghan peace talks. That is, the Afghanistan's talks need to be Afghan owned, Afghan controlled, and Afghan led. And into this particular thing, the understanding part into the various factions into the Afghanistan has always been talked by India. So into this particular context, this quote becomes relevant even for GS paper number 2. So guys, that is all about this GS folder, and now we'll be taking up the newspaper articles in detail. Now friends, taking up the first article, this article has been taken from the Indian Express newspaper, and it becomes important for our GS paper number 1 as well as GS paper number 2, social justice. Now guys, here we can see that the Niti Aayog is actually giving a kind of a suggestion that under the National Food Security Act of 2013, the coverage umbrella needs to be reduced. Now before understanding this particular thing, let's take some of the basic information. Guys, it has been seen that into the past few years, government is focusing on increasing the entitlement for the poor people so that they can be given more effective social justice. And when we talk about entitlement, the basic necessities are being given as a matter of right. For example, right to education, for example, right to food. Now, right to food is given under the National Food Security Act of 2013. Here, there are the households which have been divided in two categories. Number one are the Antyodaya Anyojana household, which are approximately 2.37 crore households. Now, these are the most poorest of the ones, and they are given 35 kg of food grain to per household every month. Then the others are the priority households. Now here, per person, 5 kg food grains are given on highly subsidized prices. Now guys, it has been seen that since 2013, when this particular act has came into the place, it has not been updated because every year population is increasing. Now into the 2020, it has been said that now the beneficiary list under the NFSA is needed to be updated. Now guys, if we talk about the coverage of NFSA in terms of population percentage, then guys, it covers approximately 75% people into the rural areas and 50% people into the urban areas, and collectively on pan-India basis, it covers more than 67% of the population. And if we talk about it in terms of number, then approximately 81 crore people are getting the subsidized food under the NFSA. And see, now if the updation will be done onto the basis of the population increase, then this 81 crore beneficiaries will increase to 89 crore. And then guys, what will happen? Additional subsidy burden will fall onto the center. And therefore, now the government is exploring that how this particular increased financial burden can be mitigated. So under that particular thing, the suggestion was asked from the Niti Aayog. Now, what Niti Aayog had suggested? It has suggested that under the NFSA, new kind of strategy is needed. Here, they have suggested the 60:40 ratio. Now, 60:40 ratio means that earlier into the rural areas, we were covering 75% people. In place of it, cover just 60%. And in urban areas, we were covering the 50% people. Now, in place of 50, just cover the 40% of the people. Now, by this particular thing, what will happen? There will not be an increase. Rather, there will be a net saving. And that net saving will reduce the government's fiscal deficit, particularly the revenue deficit. According to the Niti Aayog, it has been said that more than 47,000 crore rupees will be saved by this particular way. Now guys, a question comes that whether such a kind of a thing will be appreciated into the times of pandemic, where the hunger has been a very important problem, very big problem. We have seen that into the global hunger index, India's rank has been 94, and we have declined even below the Bangladesh and sub-Saharan African countries. So therefore, such a kind of a suggestion into such kind of times will be enforcing the social justice is a questionable. Moreover, giving the more entitlement is not only important for the social justice, rather guys, guys, what happens when more and more entitlements are given, the people are left with more disposable income. And as this disposable income will be spent, it will increase the aggregate demand. And as aggregate demand will increase, it will give impetus to the industries, and therefore they will hire the people, employment will be created, and entire economy will come into the velocity, and the economic growth can again be attained. So guys, all these particular matters will be there if this particular Niti Aayog's report will be considered. So guys, that is all, and now we'll be taking up the next article. Now guys, this article has been taken from the Hindu newspaper, and it can be used as a case study for your GS paper number 2 into the questions related to the education, where you can provide a kind of a way forward. Now guys, what has happened? The Delhi government has created the Delhi Board of School Education. Now this particular board will enforce that the holistic education is being provided to the students. Now this particular board's emphasis will be on to the 3-pronged strategy. Number 1, it will aim to end practice of rote learning, and it will encourage the holistic development of every learner. Into this particular thing, they will focus that how entrepreneurship and all such kind of things can be taught. Then guys, the emphasis will be made onto the continuous formative assessment. It has been seen basically into the India that the examinations just evoke the fear, and there is no focus onto the objective assessment of the learning into the child. Now guys, but this particular board will emphasize that the assessment system should become a partner of learning, and it is not just an authority of testing. Then the third thing that will be focused by this particular board will be, it will encourage a growth mindset among the students. Now guys, it has been seen that the Delhi government has done many of experiments. For example, it is running the happiness curriculum, entrepreneurship mindset curriculum, then there is a Desh Bhakti curriculum, which is focusing not only on the rote learning, but also inculcating the values, ethics, and the customs which are needed for the necessary growth. After that guys, it has been provided that this particular board will also focus onto the democratic principles of feedback taking and working onto the basis of evidence. For example, the board will empower the teachers to achieve students' full potential by giving the teachers the timely feedback onto the specific actions that are to be taken in order to expedite the skills and learning of the children. After that guys, there will also be focus onto employing the IT solutions. For example, effective modern technology will be used to ensure personalized learning experience for the student. And basically this is a very good development into this particular line. Now guys, a few days back we have also seen that government is also focusing on building the schools for excellence, which will be focusing on specific disciplines and will nurture the gifted children. And after that, this is even more a good kind of development, and collectively it will also guys help in enforcing the objectives of the new education policy 2020, which has been released by the government last year. So guys, this particular case study or example you can give into your answers in a way forward. So that is all, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this particular advertorial has been taken from the Hindu newspaper, and it is talking about some of the points where India and Taiwan can cooperate. And guys, we can utilize again this particular thing as an example of the cooperation between the two countries. If a question is asked into the IR as well as onto the ecology also, the example of the Taiwan can be given. So this article will be important for your GS paper number 2 as well as for GS paper number 3. Now here the reference has been given that the Taiwan has switched to win-win circle economy framework into the recent years. Now the win-win circular economy framework focuses on 3 R, that is recycle, reuse and refuse. However, if we see the other developing countries such as India particularly, we focus more on the take make waste model. Now the take make waste is that take the raw material, make a finished product, and as this finished product's utility has been completed, just waste it, put it into the dump and all such kind of things. And it is a linear model of economy. Now this linear model of economy is not sustainable into the long term, and as the sustainable developmental goals have a specific target to reduce the consumption, so the linear model cannot be continued. We need to learn from the Taiwanese model of win-win circular economy framework. Now guys, here we can see that what Taiwan is doing. So it is recycling, reusing, refusing all the kind of products, and particularly giving them a kind of a orientation that these products don't become a burden onto the economy as well as ecology, rather they becomes again more of utilitarian. Now guys, you don't need to go and give the product specific examples. Rather, we can talk about a broader policy of the Taiwan, that is the New Southbound policy. Now, under the New Southbound policy, what Taiwan has done? Taiwan is redefining its role into the region and working on enhanced relation with the neighboring countries. Now here, it is focusing on all these countries. In particular, there are the 18 countries and India is one of them. Now, the Taiwan is giving them the technology transfer so that their dependence onto the China can be reduced and the Taiwan can become a meaningful player. Now guys, under this, what has happened under the New Southbound policy, there is 5+2 industrial innovation program where much of the sustainability with respect to the industrial products is being taught to the different countries, and India can take advantage of it. Moreover, there is also the Taipei Economic and Cultural Center, which is willing to give India the technologies to promote the green energy, to work onto the ways to achieve the circular economy and all such kind of things. So guys, readily the technology transfer can be given by the Taipei Economic and Cultural Center. So onto all these particular things, the Taiwan potential is needed to be exploited, because guys, India is also looking for the Atmanirbharta, and into that the cooperation from the Taiwan can be very much fruitful. So guys, that is all about this particular article, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Friends, this article has been taken from the Hindu newspaper and it talks about the empowerment of the women via the dairy farming. Now guys, when we talk about the month of March was celebrated as Women's History Month. And here the milestones which helped in achieving the empowerment for the women also becomes very much important. And into the context of India, the dairy is one of that sector. And guys, not only they had helped the women, rather women had also increased the dairy production in India and helped to achieve the white revolution in India. Now guys, this particular thing had happened despite of small land holdings in India as well as small cattle size which had just 2 to 5 cows. Now what has happened? As the women came out in large and large number, cooperated with these cooperatives, the income generation had happened which had facilitated the women to become more and more empowered. And as few women became empowered initially, they had motivated the other women and they are also joining more and more cooperatives. So what has happened? A kind of a positive circular reinforcement is happening in India. First of all, corporates help in the income generation to the women. By seeing them, the other women come and make the cooperative more stronger. Then these stronger cooperatives help in further empowerment of the women. Then even more women are coming and all such kind of thing is happening. Now, there the reference has been given that when we talk about the dairy into the India, not only it has provided the income, but it has also freed the small farmers from the clutches of the middlemen who often exploited them and ate the majority of the margins. Moreover, it is there that these dairy development plants, they are also organizing the farmers orientation program across the country, where the farmers are being trained into the scientific best practices, animal health, fodder quality, clean milk production, account management, etc. And guys, this thing, that giving a know-how is very much instrumental into the empowerment, has been reflected by a study carried by the International Development Research Center, where it has been provided that when you give the knowledge as well as finance, then 93% of the women, they succeed into their venture. And if you give just them the money, then the success rate is just 57%. So money is not only the factor, rather the know-how is also the factor. So when the women are associating with the cooperatives, cooperatives give them the knowledge, and by that knowledge, their success ratio even more increases. And now guys, if we talk specifically about the incomes, then it can be seen that into the India, there are more than 190,000 dairy cooperatives and they are employing approximately 6 million women members. And according to the various studies, it has been seen that income generation through dairy is now a significant factor. 31% of the women, they had converted their mud houses to cement structures by the income generated through selling of the milk. Moreover, it has also helped in grooming the women for the leadership position, because by the financial and economic empowerment, the empowerment in other avenues also follow. Then guys, the success stories have also been given of some of the women. You can use it as a reference. Now here, the success story of the Prem Bai from Rajasthan has been given, who didn't had any access to education or formal employment, but still she became the member of the Bhilwada Milk Union, and now she is the main breadwinner, and even bought more than 25 acres of land and is living the life of dignity. And the story not only ends here, even the Amul has also released last year a list of 10 women who are the dairy farmers and they had become millionaires by selling milk to the company. Their names have also been given. Now you don't need to remember all these names. But guys, there is also one problem that comes here, that there is the information asymmetry into this industry. It has been seen that 50 to 70% of the farmers, they don't have the accessibility to the resources in terms of information that is needed. And into this particular line, the National Dairy Development Board is working efficiently, but still much more focus is to be given. So guys, this is one or more dimension where the women can be involved. Now, apart from this, the women also have a particular potential to be employed into the low-end manufacturing, that is the manufacturing in textiles, shoes, and all such kind of thing. That is also one suggestion that was given by the economic survey. So guys, this is one particular aspect where the women labor force participation rate needs to be enhanced even more, and their association with the cooperatives need to be focused. So guys, that is all about it, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this article has been taken from the Indian Express newspaper, and here the reference of the Heart of Asia conference has been given, which is now being attended by the External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar. Now first of all, the Heart of Asia conference, it is also called as the Istanbul process, and was the initiative which was started by the Turkey and Afghanistan after 2011 to enhance the regional cooperation, to focus on economic cooperation, political cooperation, as well as to enhance the security in to the region. Moreover guys, the focus on building the confidence building measures is also been given. Now if we talk about the Heart of Asia conference, there are 14 participating countries and 16 supporting countries. Now the 14 participating countries are within the region, whereas the supporting countries can be outside the region also. Now guys, into the Heart of Asia conference, this year the 9th edition has been held, and it is being held into the Tajikistan, into the Dushanbe, and the Minister of External Affairs has made a visit into the conference, and there he had talked mainly on two of the things. Number one, on to the double peace, where he had emphasized that the peace within the Afghanistan is to be enforced right now, because the peace process between the Afghanistan government and Taliban is going on, and then not only into the Afghanistan but into the entire region, the peace and prosperity is to be secured. After that guys, the MEA has also talked about the intra-Afghan negotiations and their importance. Now into the intra-Afghan negotiations, there will be one Afghanistan government and other will be the Taliban, and this is a very rare reference, because never India holds a ideology that the negotiation with the terrorist organization is to be done. But now, as he has emphasized, a kind of a different way into the Indian diplomacy is being observed, which can be a way to find a kind of a breakthrough into a stalled kind of process. And after that, he had also launched a large number of regional connectivity initiatives also, which is India's Air Corridor program, as well as Chabahar project, as well as the Turkmenistan Afghanistan Pakistan India pipeline. So guys, this is all about the Heart of Asia conference. I hope that you have understood it, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Guys, this article has been taken from the Hindu newspaper, and it talks about a new butterfly that has been found in Agasthyamalai into the Western Ghats. First of all, here the reference has been given of the lepidopterist. Now they are the people who study or collect the butterflies. Now they have found a new species of butterfly, that is the Nakaduba Sinhala Rameshwami Sadashivan 2021. Now this butterfly has been placed into the journal of the threatened taxa, and therefore there is also a threat to the existence of this particular butterfly. Now the important of this particular research is that for the first time this butterfly species has been discovered by an all India research team from the Western Ghats. So guys, just for the prelims, keep it into your mind. That is all, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Friends, this article has been taken from the Hindu newspaper, and here we can see that how into the present times the researchers are facing even bigger kind of problem because of the frequent raids that are being made by the police and the enforcement agencies onto them. So a plea has been made into the Supreme Court, where it has been said that the academic freedom is being taken, because into the raids often the seizures are made by the police, and into that the confiscation is often made for the computers, hard disk, and all such kind of things which belong to the academicians and into that particular thing, the academics lose their life's work when police carry off them and don't give them, or they get destroyed into the transit or into the rough handling. Even there are many a times the patentable material which are existing onto such kind of computers, and it gets compromised into the process. So therefore, a kind of a need of a standard operating procedure or a framework is there, so that there is a process into the raids and the seizures, so that the lifetime work is not lost. So guys, this is all about this particular thing. I hope that you have understood it, and that is for all for the today's newspaper analysis, guys. I hope that you are liking it and you are finding it fruitful for your preparation. Thank you so much.